beautiful day the Most High has given us. I will truly enter into His gates with thanksgiving. Does anybody in the house have anything to be thankful for? Has there been a darkness removed from your life? Do you now but walk in the marvelous light of the power of God, the presence, the Holy Ghost? God, I thank You for that today. I enter into that today, God. Search my heart, O God. Cleanse me this day, I pray. Let my mind, let my spirit and my attitude, let it be right, God. Let it be but acceptable in Thy sight today. I will lift up my hands today. I will lift up my voice today because You are but worthy. Church, He's worthy today. Can we take a moment? Father, we love You this day. Thank You, oh God, for the darkness that has been removed from my life. Nothing short of the miraculous touch of the Most High God. I pray for Your people today. I pray, God, and I thank You for the spirit of expectancy that I believe but is in the house of God today. Lord, as we would come by faith, lifting up our hearts and our desires, lifting up, oh God, our petitions before You, because we believe, God, today that You are able to keep, oh God, that which we have committed. We praise and we magnify You today. Be exalted, oh God, in our midst, I ask. Be exalted, oh God, in each and every life. For what we bring, Lord, we bring ourselves. Transform us, oh God, into You, into Your will today. God, be exalted in this house. Be magnified, I pray, in but the name of Jesus. Can we clap into the Most High? God, You are worthy. Lord Jesus, You are worthy. Father, You are worthy. God, You are worthy today. I bless You today. Hallelujah.
Up to the Lord, for He's worthy of our praise. Lift your voice in one accord, hearts and hands we humbly raise. For He's the same, He's never changed. So we come to lift up His name. Lift your hands up to the Lord. Hearts and hands we humbly raise, for He's the
of my best. You're worthy of my everything. You're worthy today. Oh, holy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. We exalt your name, Jesus. We invite you to have your way in this place, oh God. Be exalted and receive our praise as we lift it to you. Hallelujah. God bless you. You can make your way back to your seat. So good to be in the house of the Lord with you today. Commend you on your worship. Just lift up the name of Jesus. I was praying and thinking, I wonder what would happen in this place today if every single mature individual would push aside every other distraction and just for the next hour, hour and a half, focus on, God, what do you want to do in this place? What do you want to do in me? How do you want me to respond to your presence? I just wonder what it would be like. The scripture says that it's at that place of unity where God commands his blessing. And can I tell you, when God commands something, there is nothing that can stand in the way of it. But it's only when we can come together in that place of unity, of worship, of humility, saying, God, I don't have everything I need. I need something from you today. And maybe I don't even know what it is, but you do. And so I surrender to your will today. Would you guide my mind? Would you lead me, Lord, as I just give my praise and glory to you today? Would you do that together? Would you just forget about everything else? What you're going to do later on today, that'll come. Maybe. Maybe he will come before that comes. And if that's the case, I want him to come finding me, giving him my everything. Everything that is within me, God, I want to give you glory. So as we continue to sing, push every other thought out of your mind and say, God, how can I give you more glory? Because you're worthy than so much more than I've ever given you. God, be glorified in this place.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind. soon dissolve like snow, and the sun forbear to shine. Oh, but God, who's called me here below, will be forever mine. Oh, will be forever mine. Yeah, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior,
thank Him for love that is unending. It endures all things. It hopes all things. It endures to the end. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jesus, your amazing grace. We give you praise. We give you thanks for that. We don't deserve it, but we're so thankful for your love, for your mercy, for your grace towards us. In Jesus' name, Lord, bless you. You may be seated. Welcome to the Pentecostals of Peoria. Wonderful Spirit of the Lord. Thank you for joining in prayer. Thank you for joining in worship. We're having a marriage retreat this Friday night and this Saturday in our neighboring church in Bloomington. For only $40, all your food is covered. The retreat material is covered. Good fellowship's covered. That's for a couple, so only $20 per person. Going to be a wonderful time. I know four couples going, but the Lashley and his wife, my wife, we are going, and a couple other couples. If you want to, we'll have more announcements about it Wednesday night, probably get together and plan out travel arrangements. But a wonderful opportunity with Brother Blash. Reading the scripture this morning about Hagar. Just after she'd been treated badly by Abraham and by Sarah, and yet God sees her in her point of despair. And she says, God, you are the God who sees me. And oh, I think about that in such a beautiful way. No matter what your circumstance is, no matter where you're at today, in the lowest of her despair, Hagar recognized, God sees my situation, and He's preparing something for my future. Are you thankful that God sees you right where you're at right now? You don't have to get good in order for Him to see. He knows right where you're at. And in today's service, if you'll offer Him the opportunity, Lord, I ask you to bless me. He'll wash away that pain, that fear, that worry. He'll anoint you with the blessing of His Spirit. And some of our brothers and sisters are in need of that anointing today. Ask your continued prayer for the Lutz family. Brother Lutz's visitation will be here at the church tomorrow evening from 5 to 7 o'clock. And then the funeral will be here on Tuesday at 11 a.m. with a graveside service at Springtill Cemetery. Also asking that you remember the DePinto family. Brother Bruce lost his mother Saturday, just pain upon pain. Ask for God's blessings and comfort to that family. The Ville family also asking for prayer for Sister Angelo Presti. We had prayer for her last week. She had an MRI this week, and doctors found more opportunities for God to show Himself mighty. Some things doctors don't care to see, not sure what exactly it means. Of course, the enemy wants to taint your mind, worry you. Opportunity for God to do a beautiful work in that situation. Believe He's doing it. Also, continue to remember Brother Bill Carter, Brother Vince, asking God to do a mighty work in them, Sister Rob's husband, asking God to touch these things we've been bringing on a continual basis. God bless and to anoint them. For ushers will come and receive the offering. We'll ask God's blessings upon the remainder of this service. Psalms 107:20. I love the verse because it talks, He sent His word and it healed them. I believe they don't even have to be present. If you in faith ask, God can send his word and touch that situation. Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for your name that has all power. And we gather together as the family of God, as the believers in this community, asking your anointing to be upon these situations, upon these brothers and sisters who are needing comfort in their time of need and of grief, needing healing in their bodies. God, I ask you to minister to Brother Bill Carter and to Brother Vince, to Sister Angie Jesus. I ask you to minister comfort and blessing to the DePintos and to the Lutz family. Bless the body of Christ. Anoint the service today. You know what your purpose is for every one of us. I rebuke every distraction, every hindrance. I ask you to open up hearts to receive your word, to receive healing and restoration, conviction and anointing of the Holy Ghost. God, I ask your anointing upon this tithe and offering as we give it to you with joy. We praise you. We give you glory in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Would you give him another hand clap of praise? God, you are great. You are worthy. We bless you. We honor you. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
We're in time.
my comfort. He's my dearest friend. He's been my strength in every trial. Oh, God's been good to me.
Oh, God's been good to me.
Oh, God's been good to me.
When my soul's in me,
soul,
He provides for me.
He provides for me. God's been good. He's been good.
Whether you Recognize it or not, He has. Amen. You may be seated. Recently, I read several booklets. They say anything less than 100 pages a booklet. And I noticed that in the front of every one of them, they have this little phrase called disclaimer. Anybody ever seen a writing that said up front, disclaimer? Well, let me give you a proclaimer. Is that all right? Cracker Barrel, and by the way, if you're looking for good old country cooking, that's a good place to go. They can pay me my commission later. Cracker Barrel has made In the Spirit of Pleasing People a nationally known phrase. But the spirit of being a people pleaser didn't begin with a 20th century food chain. Back in Galatians chapter 1, 1967 years ago, the Apostle Paul said, "For do I persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ." Man pleaser or the man pleaser? Hello? Verse 11, "But I certify you, brethren," or "I take you to task," or "I lay before you the proof, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after men." In other words, it's not something that a man made up or a group of men come together and decided, well, this is the new thing we're going to proclaim. "For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ." Paul said, "I'm not a people pleaser, and I don't preach to please people." First, those of you that know me know that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 1, Paul said, "Ye have received of us how you ought," everybody say ought, "how you ought to walk and to please God so that you would abound more and more." God wants you to be blessed and to be blessed and to be blessed, but He's the one that determines what the blessing is. We are not a part of a name it and claim it, blab it and grab it. Hello? We are a people that want to walk honestly and honorably before the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all of thine heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of His heart. Because a heart that's delighting itself in the Lordship of Jesus Christ will receive the anointing of God that will. Help me. Philippians chapter 1. What is it? Verse 5, 6. "He is in you who both will and will perform of His good pleasure." And so it is. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. "For the time will come when they," speaking of people, "will not endure," they won't put up with, "sound doctrine. But after their own lust desires shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they will turn away their ears from the truth, and they shall be turned into fables." Because they don't want, thus saith the word of God, they would prefer somebody put a political spin on it. Hello? The easy religion is always the false religion. Hello? In this world, the popular faith is not the faith of this book. Hello? It isn't. The New International Version, whom I often say the nearly inspired version, of that same 2 Timothy 4, says, "For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear." Hello? "They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside unto myths." Now, I don't preach the Bible to fit people's lifestyle. Hello? And I don't preach the people or preach the word to be patted on the back. But I preach the Bible to change people's life and lifestyle to be pleasing in the sight of God. And if you'll be pleasing in the sight of God, you'll even be pleased yourself. You won't have to pretend to pretense. You'll have it. Luke chapter 9, verse 23, Jesus said, "If a man will come after me, let him," hello, "deny himself." That's the first hurdle that the flesh really falls on. If he's going to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross. Notice the next word, daily. This is a daily thing. Lady told me one time, she said, I just won't be coming back to your church. I said, well, I wish that weren't so, but could you tell me why? She said, well, I just can't live Christian faith like you preach it. I said, oh, really? How do I preach it? She said, will you just make it so daily? I said, oh, like brushing your teeth? Taking a bath? Hello? Other things that you know are daily. Well, why not living for God daily? Hello? Since in Jesus' day it wasn't on the Sabbath day only. It didn't happen on just the year of Pentecost only or the year of Jubilee only. He said, take up your cross and follow me. And I've heard folks say, well, you know, we got this problem, child, and that's our cross. Don't lie to yourself. And don't you let the devil lie to you. The cross is never something that is forced on you. You have to volunteer for it. Hello? Come on, the cross was not forced upon Jesus. He said, I can call legions of angels right now. I don't have to go there. And folks, your cross is God's call to you. It's not forced upon you, but you have to make up your mind. I'm going to take up the will of God for my life, and I'm going to carry it daily. And how am I going to carry it? He said, and follow me. For whosoever shall save his life, that is, I'm going to live it the way I want to live it, shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake, that is, divest himself of his own will and commit himself unto my will and make it my will, his will, then that same person shall be saved. For what is a man advantaged if he gain the whole world and lose himself and be a castaway? The Message translation says, anyone who tends to come with me has got to let me lead. Just that simple. I've heard folks blame everything you can imagine on God led me, God told me. If it don't line up with this book, and if it doesn't line up with the holy nature and character of Almighty God, then please just take responsibility for yourself and say, that's what I wanted to do. Don't blame God with it. Hello? He says, if you're going to follow me, if you're going to come with me, then you're going to have to let me lead. You are not in the driver's seat. Boy, that just smacks the old man right in the face, doesn't it? Oh, who's going to tell me? Nobody if you want to go to hell. Nobody if you just want to be lost. But if you want to be saved, if you want to be happy, if you want love, if you want joy, if you want peace, if you want righteousness, God's going to tell you, and he's going to tell you by his word and his spirit. And they do agree. I've heard people say, well, the Spirit of the Lord told me, and it contradicts exactly what the Word of God says. I said, well, isn't that amazing? Here's what the book says, and what you just said, the Spirit of the Lord said, contradicts what the Word is written. Hello? Hey, folks. I'm just trying to be true to the book. Self-help, I'm just reading from the Message translation, verse 24. Self-help is no help at all. Self-sacrifice is the way, my way, to finding yourself, your true self. What good would it do to get everything you want and lose you, the real you? John 10:10, Jesus said, I am come. Now the enemy, the devil comes, but to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But I am come that they might have life and have it. Somebody help me with that. more abundant. Amen. Beyond anything you can ever imagine, having your way, having your say, doing as you please. You can just bump alone if you want to and live life like a pinball inside of a pinball machine and be bounced and slapped and knocked and tripped. But oh, thank God, when the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. Amen. He restoreth my soul. And he leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. God's word is revelatory. It turns the light on. God's word is life-giving. And it is life-transforming. So if you want a relationship with God, get into God's word. Hello? If you want a relationship with God, get into God's word. Turn with me, if you will, to Ezekiel chapter 37. I want to read several verses here. Now, after about 25 or 30 verses, I'll get to my text. Is that okay? Well, it's got to be. Ezekiel 37, verses 4 through 10. Amen. We're so grateful today. Cassandra, where are you? There she is. Glad you're here today. Amen. Stephanie, where are you? There she is. Bless her heart. And Shane, we're so grateful you folks are with us, and all the rest of you as well. Amen. Ezekiel 37 and 4, the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of bones. And it caused me to pass about them round and about, and behold, there were very many in the open valley. And lo, they weren't just dead. They weren't just dry. They were disconnected. They were very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. Again he said unto me, Prophesy upon these bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones. Everybody got the picture? It's not a graveyard. They're not buried. It's just a great big wasteland valley. And it's strewn with bones as if there had been a battle there. And the slain had just been left for the buzzards to pick and the coyotes and whatever, amen, to just snatch the bones hither and thither. And there they are. And God says, I want you to prophesy upon those bones. And this is what you tell the dead, dry, disconnected bones to do. Now, folks, if dead, dry, disconnected bones can hear the word of God and be blessed by the word of God and be transformed. Come on, folks. Amen. If that can happen to dead, dry bones, how many believe it can happen to you? It can happen to me. It can happen to us if we'll just hear the word of the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones. Behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. He's talking to dead, dry bones. And I will lay sinews upon you, and I'll bring flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And not only shall you live, you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as, catch this phrase, as I prophesied, things take place while the word of God is going forth. I've seen people receive miracle healings while the word was being proclaimed. I've seen people rise to their feet, lift their hands, and receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. While the word of the Lord, come on, folks, I'm telling you, we need to entertain the word of God as it is indeed the word of God. It is the breath of life. It is the essence of life. It is the very heart and soul of life. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. Hello? They're not even alive yet. They're still dry. They don't have sinew, nor flesh, nor skin. Hello? He said, I'm just prophesying. And while the word of the Lord is going forth, that's the word that said, in the beginning, let there be, and there was. Folks, if we could ever grasp the first five words of the Holy Bible, we'd never stumble over anything else. God creates with a voice, with a breath, with an utterance. And if we could let that same word be received into our heart by faith, by persuasion, by trust, by confidence, by believing in Him, and what he says, you cannot imagine what God could do for you, and do it so quick it'd make your head spin. Oh, we're so used to everything taking a long time. I'm going to tell you what, microwaves are slow compared to God. In a moment and in a twinkling of an eye. Notice this. The nearest thing you're going to come to this in the Bible is Luke chapter 1, verse 44. Brethren, you don't have to go there, remember. Luke 1, 44, it says that when Mary greeted Martha, or Elizabeth, when Mary greeted Elizabeth, the babe within Elizabeth's womb leaped for joy. I call that the moving of the yet unborn. Well, Brother Lashley, I felt the Spirit of the Lord. So did these bones. Hello? Hello? There was just a noise. There was a shaking. What caused that? The word of the Lord. God's been good to me. Hello? When did God start being good to you? When you found out about him? Oh, no, honey. Like me, God was being good to you and me long, long before we ever woke up and said, oh, that's God. Come on, why can't we just let that God that was good to us before Christ continue to be good for us in Christ and lead us and direct us into life eternal? Oh, I'm so thankful we can. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. Notice, they still were dead. They had moved. They had felt an impact. There had been an alignment, bone to his bone. There had been sinews that come upon those bones and held them together in a cohesive skeleton. There had been flesh that came upon those bones. There had been skin that come upon their bones, but there still to this moment is not even a breath of life in them. Folks, I'm here to tell you, God works with dead folks for a long time before they become alive. I was dead in my trespasses and sins. Anybody here was too? Hello. How many of you had the voice of God speak to your heart and you didn't even recognize it, but later you said, that was God talking to me. And you were dead in your sins. Hello? Oh, my Lord Jesus, there's so much here and I just can't get it all. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the breath came upon them, the skin covered them from above, but there was no breath in them. Then said he, that is God, unto me, prophesy unto the wind. Leave the bones alone, just talk to the wind, or the breath, or the spirit. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain. Folks, we were slain in sin. Hello? That they may live. We want to live in Christ. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceeding great army. I'm telling you, God's word gives life. God's word transforms life. God's word is revelatory. God's word will challenge you. God's word will change your paradigms. God's word will change your beliefs and your concepts. God's word will give you life, and it will change your life according to his word. John 6:33, the words Jesus said that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. I find it unique that the Bible being divided into Old and New Testaments, some 39 books in the Old Testament, some 27 books in the New Testament, Old Testament largely written in Hebrew, New Testament written in Greek, that just in the 27 books of the New Testament, which are written in Greek, there's about 5,594 Greek words. 5,594 thereabouts. And when studying the Word, preaching the Word, are teaching the word, our responsibility, our goal, our desire is to determine the meaning of each word in its proper biblical concept. That's why, anybody ever seen this thought about real estate? What is the word about what's real estate? Location, location, location. In the scripture, if you want the truth, you got to find context, context, context. Don't take a scripture out of context and try to make it apply somewhere else. Heard the story about a guy. He said he was just praying. He said, "Now, Lord God, I'm just going to shut my eyes, open my Bible, put my finger down, and whatever verse it falls on, that's what I'm going to receive." So he did it, and the verse said, and Judas went out and hanged himself. He said, "Oh, no, oh, God, that just can't be what you want from me. So I'm going to do it again. I'm going to close my eyes. I'm going to open the Bible, and I'm going to put my finger on the scripture, and whatever it says, I'm going to accept it." It says, "Go thou and do likewise." Folks, the responsibility as we go to the Word of God, first of all, is to receive it as the Word of God and then do everything in our power to understand what the Scripture is saying within its context. Can you say amen? And the reason for that is because these 5,594 approximate Greek words can have over 25,000 different meanings. And so you have to look into the scripture to see what is he saying. Oh, hallelujah. And these words are life, and they are breath, and they are spirit. In 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 and 17, it says, all scripture is given by is inspired of God. What is it? All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it is profitable. What's it profitable for? Doctrine, that means teaching. Number two, for reproof, that means, whoop, wait a minute, that's not the right way. Number three is for correction. And then number four is for instruction in righteousness. God says, I want to teach you the true and right way. I want to reprove you. And I've oftentimes said this, your spirituality is not measured in how gifted you may be. You may talk in tongues like angels, and you may prophesy, and every precise thing you say comes to pass. That don't mean you're spiritually mature. That means God has anointed you with a gifting. But you can determine your spiritual maturity by how quickly you get over being reproved. Hello? You ever seen a child that sulked after it got corrected? Shame on the parent that allows it. It's not the child's fault. Hello? Move on. I'm sorry. I pastored too many years to be evangelistic. The New International Version again says, God breathed. Every scripture is God breathed, useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. God ordained that you and I be born again. Now, he's not going to make us. God ordained that being born again, that we should live a new life, walking after the Spirit, in the Spirit, without condemnation. But he's not going to make us. God ordained certain good works to take place in our life. But if we fool ourselves and send ourselves back and say, well, that don't apply to me, and I really am not that mature. Come on, folks, wake up and realize God's got work for you to do. He's got a witness for you to be. He's got a place in worship for you to lift your heart, lift your hands, lift your voice. God wants you to have a liberty in Christ to really live and to live more abundantly. He truly, truly does. Amen. Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4 says, the just shall live by his faith. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6 says, but without faith it is impossible to please him, that is God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is the rewarder of them that, help me, diligently seek him. Ephesians 2 and 8 says, for by grace ye are ye saved, even through faith. Everybody say, through faith. And that not of yourselves, it's a gift of God. Faith is so vital. Without it, you can't please God. Without it, you can't be saved. So what is it? Oh, I know, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But what is the essence of faith? The Bible talks about faith, and I don't have time to go into all of it. Maybe today I'll just not even get finished with this one. But personal faith, that is confidence, trust, and compliance. Everybody say compliance. Confidence, trust, and compliance with the testimony of God. That is, with the Word of God. That's faith. I have confidence toward God. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? That was the first step of Abraham's faith before he ever left the land of Ur of the Chaldees. Hello? And then he complied. The Bible said, by faith, he went out. He obeyed. And then by faith, he continued to walk with God. So what is faith? Personal faith. Jesus said that if your brother trespasses against you 70 times 7 and he does it all in one day, forgive him. If he turned to you and say, I repent. Didn't say. At first it says, and if he repent, forgive him. And if he turned to you and say, I repent. Just take him at the base of his word and forgive him. What was the disciples' response to that in Luke chapter 17 and verse 5? Huh? They said, Lord, increase our faith. That's a hard pill to swallow. That's a big bite to chew. That really goes against everything. I mean, do me wrong once. What's the old saying? Do me wrong once, shame on you. Do me wrong twice, shame on me. Simply meaning, you cut me once, and you'll never get a chance to cut me again. But the Lord said, if he repent and say, I repent, then you forgive him. And Peter said, seven times? Till seven times? And the Lord said, I said not unto thee seven times, but 70 times seven. And they said, Lord, increase our faith. Increase our confidence. Increase our trust in you, that you really know what you're talking. Come on, how many of you really believe God knows what he's talking about? And he didn't talk in circles. It's a little here and a little there. Amen. But it's line upon line, and it's precept upon precept. It's like a jigsaw puzzle. The piece fits if you'll find it. I mean, you ever seen a puzzle that someone that was impatient put together? And he had pieces that were forced into the spot. Didn't exactly line up, but I'm going to finish this puzzle. Yeah, you are, several ways. James chapter 2 and verse 18. James said, show me thy faith. He talks about if a man say he have faith. Isn't that the dispensation we're living in? Isn't that the hour of a social and spiritual, or not spiritual, social and religious reality is just make a profession of faith. You say you believe. Hello? Make a profession. All right? James said, you made a profession. You say you have faith. Then he asked, show it to me. Faith is visible. It has earmarks. It has evidence. It's more than just me verbalizing something. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4 tells me the power of our personal faith. It says, this is the victory that takes on all opponents. It overcometh the world. It once overcame, it today overcomes, it will tomorrow overcome. It continues. My confidence in God, my persuasion that the testimony of God is true. God cannot lie. God's word is real. I can depend on it. I can stand on it. The word is the essence and the heartbeat. It is the root structure. It is the fertile soil from which my faith, my personal persuasion arises. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Now that's personal faith. Now there are some 42 other verses of the Bible that talks not about personal. It's only personal when you claim it. Personal, your personal faith is your persuasion, your confidence, your trust, your believing. You're aligning yourself in obedience. You are complying with thus saith the word of God. That's you in the exercise of your personal faith. I'll try to confine myself to that. But there's 42 other verses in the scripture that speak about the faith. Everybody say the faith. And that's not just your personal persuasion. That's God's testimony. That's thus saith the word of God. That's the body of truth that is comprised and embraced within what we call the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the faith. He said, Paul said, we've received grace for the obedience to the faith, the faith. The Bible says in Acts chapter 6 that there were many of the priests that became obedient to the faith. The Bible says that Paul and Barnabas told the churches to continue in the faith. He wrote that we should be striving together, not against one another, but lining up in unity for the faith. And Jude says that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once and for all delivered. How many believe? How many realize that you don't get to rewrite God's word just because you don't like what's written? Hello? And it doesn't make it whether individually I do it or we all get together and we decide, now this is the kind of church I want. This is the kind of sermons I want. This is the kind of things I want to be taught. And so we're going to all get together and we're going to call this the great big church of the triple open door. Well, I'm sorry. That's just not the way it goes. The book is the book. The truth is the truth. And the faith was once and for all delivered. And when Paul comes to the end of his life, he says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. And he says, I have kept. When he said, I got a hold of the revelation of God. I got a hold of the testimony of God. And I embraced it to my heart. And I said, live or die, sink or swim. God's word is true. And I'm going to be true to it. So faith, what is it? It's vital. Essential. But what is it? I discovered a long time ago that short definitions shortchange meanings. Short definition, especially when you come to the Word of God. A short definition shortchanges the fullness of God's Word. What about grace? Oh, Brother Lashley, that's the unmerited favor of God. Folks, any and everything you get from God is unmerited. Hello? My grace is a lot more than the unmerited favor of God. What about faith? In Mark chapter 5, verse 36, there is a father who has come to the Lord. He is a ruler of the synagogue, and he has come to Jesus, and he said, Rabbi, my little 12-year-old daughter is at home, very sick, unto death. And the Lord said, I'll come and heal her. Now, this is what the Lord said. I'll come and heal her. And while he's going to heal the little girl, a woman who had had an issue, that is a hemorrhaging of blood, for 12 years. Now, she had been a very wealthy woman at one time, but she had gone to many physicians. And anybody been to the doctor lately? Hello? And they had taken all of her money and left her no better off. She still was losing blood. And in those days in Israel, it wasn't just a physical problem, it was a worship problem. Because a woman that was suffering from a blood hemorrhage was not allowed into the presence of the sanctuary, whether it was a local synagogue or whether it was the temple in Jerusalem. Because as long as she was losing blood, it was called unclean. She almost had the same problem of the leper, unclean. And she had had it for 12 years. She said within herself when she heard Jesus was coming by. How many believe we ought to talk to ourselves when we go to the house of God? What are you here for? Hello? Brother Shane, Sister Stephanie, please be merciful with me here. When I met these dear people today, I said, we're so glad you're here. And all we have to offer is spirit and truth. If you want something else, you'll have to go somewhere else. Hello? But I did notice that he found his way to the chips and dip. God bless his heart. Amen. We need to talk to ourselves when we come to the house of God. Do I feel the presence of the Lord here? What do I believe God can do for me? Do I believe there's a place for me in the presence of God? Do I believe there's a place for me in the will of God, the kingdom of God, the plan of God? And she's talking to herself. She's heard Jesus of Nazareth is coming by. And she said within herself, if I can but touch the hem of his garment, I know I shall be made whole. Come on, have you talked faith into your heart lately? Come on, have you told yourself, if I can just receive the word of God, if I can just believe the word of God, if I can just obey the word, I know God will make a difference in my life. You ever wondered what the importance was of her touching the hem of his garment? If you go to the Old Testament, there is a law in the Old Testament that every garment of a Hebrew had to have blue in the bottom of it, in the edge of it. There had to be a blue ribbon. Now what? Why, Brother Lashley? Because God said so. I've searched it out. I've searched for every kind of a meaning and symbol and that I could find. There is none, as far as my poor little brain can comprehend. But yet, it is merely a visible evidence at the bottom of all that garment that says, I'm doing this in obedience to the Word of God. And she said, if I can but touch him at the point of obedience, I know I shall be made whole. I won't need another doctor. I won't have to go in debt. I won't be unclean if I can just touch him at the point of obedience. Come on, folks, I'm telling you and I today, if we'll touch God at the point of obedience to thus saith the word, we can be made whole. We can be made clean. We can be delivered. I'm talking about faith now. And so, Jesus takes the time to deal with this woman. And while he's dealing with her, messengers come to the father of the little 12-year-old girl, whom Jesus said, I'll go and take care of, and said, don't trouble the master anymore. She's not sick, she's dead. And at that moment, can you put yourself, Brother Jason, you did such a marvelous job, as always. But you hear him say, I just put myself in that situation. Here I am, I'm Mark. And by the way, the trip that they were going to go on from where he left them, the next leg of the trip was the most dangerous and difficult and most bandit-infested area of that part of the country. And Mark says, I'm not ready for that yet. Hello? But just put yourself in that father's position. I came to him. I believed that he could work this miracle. And now, taking up time with, who in the world is this old woman anyhow? She probably did look old after losing blood for 12 years. Why did he take time with her when I got a baby dying? And now she's dead. Brother Lashley, that couldn't happen. Come on, folks. People of the Bible were people. And you and I are people. Now I have an acquaintance that wrote a book entitled, People Are Pitiful. Parentheses, we are all people. Parentheses closed. We all have some pitiful ways about us. And Jesus just turns and looks to him in Mark chapter 5, verse 36, and he says, fear not, only believe. Be not afraid, only believe. And I can't tell you how many times that scripture has been lifted totally out of a moment, directed to have strengthened the faith of a father concerning a child that's just dead, and put it over here. Just believe. That's all you got to do is just believe. Is that really what the scripture says? Find me a place, one place from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21 where it says, just believe and you're saved. It isn't there. That's what I mean when I say short definitions shortchange God's word. You need to get into the book and find line upon line, precept upon precept, so that my faith is anchored, solid, rooted greatly in thus saith the word of God. All right? In that same book, Mark 11, chapter verse 22, Jesus turns to his disciples. They've just seen a miracle take place, a fig tree that he just said, let fruit be on thee never again, or let no man pick fruit of thee, da da da. Paraphrase, okay? And they came back by and they said, lo, the tree which thou cursed has dried up. Anybody remember the story, that particular phrase? From the roots. How many know that God can already be dealing with the root problem in your life and you don't even recognize it yet? The leaves haven't wilted. The branches haven't dropped. Hello? But just give it a little time if you'll receive the word of God. Just give it a little time, and you'll find that God began his work at the root. Jesus is not into picking off leaves. He said the axe is laid to the root. Hello? We need the Lord to deal with the root, our lack of faith, our doubt, our fear, our propensity to always question, and even more so when things get tough. Hello? The devil loves to hang question marks all over our faith. Have faith in God. And this one who is the author and the finisher of our faith, according to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, said in Mark chapter 16, verse 15, preach the gospel to every creature. Verse 16, he that believeth and, everybody say believeth and. So faith is not just a matter of believing, it's and. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Or, let me put it in a little formula that I gave students some time ago. SF, saving faith equals B plus zero or B plus O. Saving faith equals believing plus obeying. There is no other kind of saving faith in the Bible. From Matthew, from Genesis, all the way through Revelation. Everybody that walked with God had to believe the testimony of God and obey the testimony of God. Can you say amen? Oh, I wish I could stop the hands on that clock, but it'd still be time passing by. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 4. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4. All the way to the Old Testament. There's a passage in this verse that is quoted three different times in the New Testament, but this is the first mentioning of it. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. Behold, his soul which is lifted up, that is, he that is full of arrogance and pride. His soul is lifted up, but it's not upright. But the just shall live by his faith. All right, we have a contrast between the ungodly, who is proud and arrogant, and the righteous, or the godly. The heart of the just is turned to God. And the desire of the just is to be God's child. I want to be obedient to my Heavenly Father. I want to be compliant with His will. I want to honor Him in all things. And it is desiring to have a close, intimate walk with Him. Many, many years ago, there was a phrase that was quite popular: saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Hey, folks, it's not a stage as, well, I'll just be saved. I'll get to the same heaven you get to, but I'm not going to be sanctified. I'm going to stay in the mainstream of sinful pleasure. No, it's not a three-step program of saved, and then sanctified, and then filled with the Holy Ghost. No, when you receive the new birth of water and spirit, when you are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ and filled with the Holy Ghost, come on, amen, you are saved, you are sanctified. Come on, help me now, and come on, you are saved, you are sanctified, not to be filled, but because you've been filled. It's that filling of God, His name and His Spirit, that is our saving and sanctifying. And we desire to have a close walk with Him. Am I talking to people today who want a close walk with God? Or you want to be like the Apostle Peter when he was in his darkest hour? He followed afar off. And when you follow afar off, sooner or later you'll find yourself warming by the wrong fire. And somebody's going to accuse you of really being his. And you're going to find that your mouth says, I don't know who you're talking about. But yes, you do. I know you've got to be one of them. You're a Galilean. And the Bible says he cursed, or he took an oath and said, I don't know the man. And Jesus turned around and said, poof, turned him to a dust ball. You know that's not what Jesus did. And the Bible says, and Jesus turned and looked at him. Anybody ever felt that eye of God was upon you? Anybody ever listening to the word feel, God's looking at me right here, right now? Anybody feel that way this afternoon? Because whether you feel it or not, there's an all-seeing eye watching every last one of us. And the Bible says, and Peter went out. And even though Jesus rose from the grave, he had to give specific instructions that included Peter. Because he knew Peter's great failure had welled up within Peter to the point that he just couldn't accept that he'd be a part of the rest. the angel says, you go tell my disciples and Peter, I'll meet them in Galilee. Folks, would you let God include you in his holy testimony? Would you let God put foundation of truth under you so that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God? And you have a persuasion, you have a confidence in God, you have a trust and a belief that God's God and he's all right. I'm talking about the essence of personal faith in God. I'm talking about the heart and the soul. Now, having said all that, can I read my text? I know that's not the way they teach you to do it, but that's okay. I was never taught to do it. Habakkuk chapter 3 and verse 16. The land is devastated. Judgment. That's the vision Habakkuk saw. He said, I saw God coming in wrath, and everywhere he stepped on the top of a mountain, the mountain just melted like a lava, like a stream. It just flowed, and he walked in judgment. I saw the land devastated. I saw the enemy decimated. I saw all the horror. And then he said, my belly trembled. Anybody ever been so scared that you shook at the core? He said, my belly trembled. And then his faith rises up. Now, this is what I've been trying to say from the beginning. This is the essence. This is the heart and the soul of personal faith toward God. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines, the labor or the produce of the olive shall fail, the field shall yield no grain, no meat, the flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there is no herd in the stalls. Folks, for a rural people, that's absolute devastation. Although everything is lost, everything is gone awry, nothing's left to hope in. Anybody ever felt you were that way? Even that much? The doctor said, and all of a sudden you had an overwhelming although. Come on, I thought I'd be real catchy today and I'd preach on stepping up with God or stepping out on God. That just don't fit me. That's not my style. Or I'd just preach about although and yet. And I'll probably deal with that, but that's not my title. Verse 18, he said, looking at everything that's gone wrong and realizing there's nothing I can do about it. Been there? Are you there? Why are we here? Verse 18. Nothing changes. Picture's the same. Pressures are what they always were. The pain is overwhelming. Yet I... Come on, anybody wants to join the prophet? Anybody want to rise up in confidence? I believe God. In the midst of the storm, Paul said, sirs, be of good cheer. I believe God. It shall be just what the word says. Here's the prophet saying, in the face of devastation, yet I will rejoice. I will leap for joy. I will shout with triumph. Amen. I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Now that, my friend, is the essence of personal faith. That's a persuasion that stands in the face of all overwhelming situations and says, the Lord God is my strength, and he will make my feet like hinds feet, like deer's, like mountain goats, and he'll make me to walk upon my high places. I may be down right now, but rejoice not against me, O my enemy, for when I fall, come on, I shall rise again. I shall make it up again, because God is my strength. The essence of having personal faith is not never failing or never having a bad day or never suffering loss or having a bad situation. The essence of faith is simple. The essence of personal faith in God is very simple. When an overwhelming although meets an unyielding yet. I'm not through till God says I'm not through. Snatch the carpet out from under me. Send the waves of the storm against me. As long as God be for me, who can be against me? I'm going to come out on the other side. And I'm going to do it rejoicing. Yet will I rejoice. Yet will I trust. Yet will I believe. Yet will I stand true. Yet will I honor God as my Lord and my God. And folks, he is, whether you honor him or not, he's still God. Personal faith, the essence of it, acknowledges God, gets up, stands up again in the holy name of Jesus. The just shall live by his faith. You ever looked that verse up? You ever looked up the meaning of the word faith in that particular verse? And according to the law of understanding Scripture, if you'll go back to the very first reference, it's called the law of first mentioning. If you'll go back to the very first reference of a Scripture and then follow it through, you'll get a grasp of the full understanding of what it means. But some folks has taken, and the just shall live by faith, to just mean make a profession of faith. Just sincerely believe what you want to believe. Just go to the church of your choice. Whatever they teach, that's okay, just as long as you're sincere. Folks, sincerity is not salvation. The Spirit and truth of God is salvation. And none of us have got a corner on that. But you can get a corner on your personal confidence that nothing's going to shake me. Now, I got sense enough to know it's not easy to keep hoping and trusting and holding on in the face of the ugly, in the face of the incongruous, in the face of the absurd, in the face of just everything's falling apart, in the face of the enticements. Come on, join us and let's go do thus and thus. In the face of your own personal weaknesses, it's not always easy to hold on to hope. But the essence of faith is yet will I. Did you ever fallen? The just man fell, but he got up. And he fell, and he got up. And he fell, and he got up. Anybody ever had the devil tell you, you didn't get nothing from God? If you did, you wouldn't be here. No, get up. Get up. I discovered a long time ago, when I'm down, he'll reach down. And if I'll reach up, he'll lift me up. That's the essence of personal faith. It's an unyielding yet. Here I stand yet on the Word of God. Everything's overwhelming. It's although. No calves, no sheep, no olives, no vineyard, no figs, no produce, no job, sick, my child sick. Come on, folks. Yet, what are you going to do in the valley of the shadow? You are either going to walk in faith of what you can't see, or you're going to walk in fear of what you do. And I choose to believe in the invisible God. who said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'm not through. Would you give me permission to just check it right here and check this train up at a later time? Because you're through. I can tell you're through. I will say yes, yes, yes. I will say yes, yes, yes. I will say yes, Lord. I will say yes, Lord. I will say yes, yes, yes. Stand with me. Let me play with the little three-letter word yet. Y-E-T. Yes, every time. Do you believe God? Some of the time, much of the time, most of the time. That's good, but that's not good enough. No, I'm going to believe God at all times, all circumstances and situations, and every ordeal. I believe you, Lord. And I not only believe you, I want to make your will my will. Anybody here audacious enough, and I know this sounds at first as audacious, but if you think about it, it's not. Anybody here today want God to respect you? Jesus was talking to some religious people one day, leaders, and he said, how can you receive that honor that cometh only down from above when you are so taken up with that honor from one another? You want others to honor you. You want the peer group to approve. You want the guys on the job, the gals in the gang, or the gals in the club, or the whatever. You want to be approved on a horizontal. Anybody ever in just brokenness and tears saying, God, I want to honor you as God? I'm not talking about living for God. Well, I'm going to do this because I got to be saved. Folks, that's totally, totally, totally out of context with personal faith. Personal faith says God loves me and God has a divine plan of truth and righteousness to give me. God wants to give me righteousness, peace, and joy. God wants to forgive me of every wrong thought, word, and action. God wants to help me step out of the bondages of every habit. God is for me. And God wants to fill me. Now, folks, that's why I want to honor the Lord. Because he wants to honor you. He wants to honor me. The Lord said, I will honor him that honors my word. Now, I'm talking to people today that have been experiencing trauma, difficulties, uncertainties, and pain. Physical pain, financial pain. But I'm talking to you about a God who said, if you'll trust me and lean not to your own understanding, if you'll trust me and do good, if you will delight yourself in me, if you will acknowledge me in all of your ways, I'll take over. I'll bring it to pass. I'll make it work. And he will. But you got to believe his report. You got to reach up and catch a hold of the testimony of God's word and say, by this I live, and by this I'll live forever. Anybody here today, you'd like to have a real, honest, honorable, biblical, scriptural walk with God? Anybody here want to repent of your sin? Just let's just deal with it right up front. Get honest with God and say, Lord, I have sinned, and I ask you to forgive me. In the name of Jesus, I come to you and I plead the blood of Calvary. Jesus, forgive me. Folks, I'm here to tell you that if you'll confess your sin to him and turn to him and say, Lord, if you will give me grace, I will not practice this sinful way of living ever again. I don't mean you're never going to slip or stumble. It just means that that's never going to be the practice of your life again. But you're going to practice walking with God, trusting God, believing God. Could I open this altar right now and ask every one of us that wants an honorable walk with God, who realize there's any failure in your life, make your way to the altar and say, God, include me. Lord Jesus, I want to be a part of your plan. I want to be a part of your people. Come on, the door's wide open. If I can but touch the hem of his garment, if I can touch him at the point of obedience, and you can, if you'll just step out and say, God, I don't have a lot to give you. I'm all I am. But I want to be what you want me to be. Hear me, Lord. Help me, Lord. I call upon you, Jesus. I call upon you, Jesus. Come on, folks. Come on. Come on. Come on. Yet, I will trust him. Yet, I'll be up again. Yet, I will rejoice in him. Yet, I will joy in the Lord. Although it's all messed up right now, it's not going to stay that way, because God is the strength of my salvation. God is my hope and my refuge, my help. Come on, folks. Come on, just reach out to him. Open your heart. Open your mouth. Talk to him. Pour out your heart, the Bible says. Just dump it out before the Lord and say, God, you're all I hope I have. You're the all help I can get. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Come on, thank you, Jesus. You ask him for forgiveness. Come on, you can feel it lift. You can feel the burden shift, because God will put his hand under that load. Where you are right now, he's in a proper position to let God be God to you. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, begin to thank him. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you, Lord, for your patience with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank. Come on, just call upon him. Call upon him. Call upon him. Call upon him. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, that's it. Just call upon the name of the Lord. Jesus, I need you. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, help me. Oh, Lord God, I want to do your will. I want to please you.
You, Lord.
Hallelujah. 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 Come on, reach over and take somebody by the hand. Say, I'm going to stand with the Lord. I'm going to stand with you as we stand with the Lord. I'm going to stand on the Word of God. I'm going to commit myself. I'm going to commit myself to the will of God. Not my will, Lord, but thine be done. Direct my steps. Teach me thy truths. Lord, make me to understand. Oh God, show me thy ways. Lead me in the path of righteousness for your name's sake. Help me, Lord, to walk in faith in the light of your truth. Lord, in the fellowship of your presence, under the anointing. Come on, you feel his anointing here right now. That's his love. Come on, under the anointing of your spirit. Oh God, I want to behold your glory. Lord, I want to walk honorably with you and before you. Come on, you're not by yourself. You're not by yourself. The Lord is with you. Just yes, yet, yes every time. Yes, every time. Yes, every time. Lord, when you speak to my heart, I don't have to think about it. It's just yes, every time.
At all times.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Whether I'm on the mountaintop or whether I'm in the valley. Whether everything is going right or going wrong, God, you are right. And I'm going to bless you. Going to bless you. Going to bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Now, on the day of Pentecost, on the birthday of the church, Acts chapter 2, you can go home, get your Bible, read it for yourself. I've always believed in starting at the beginning, and that's where the church began. And the 120 had received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, miraculous evidence of speaking in other tongues. They never studied nor learned. They were just letting the Holy Ghost flow through them. The wind of God just blowing, as it were, like the wind of God, the breath of God moved upon the dead, dry bones. They come down out of that upper room, 120 strong, full of joy, full of rejoicing. The Bible said a great crowd gathered, and in that crowd there were folks that said, "What in the world's going on? What meaneth this?" And there were others, you know, how many know there's always folks in a crowd's got the answer? And they want you to believe they got the answer. And they say, "Well, they're drunk. They're just drunk." But they were all astonished at what was taking place. And then the man with the keys to the kingdom. Remember, Jesus said, "Peter, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom." Peter stood up and he said, "You men of Judea, Jerusalem." He said, "These men are not drunk as you suppose. But this is that." And he took them immediately back to the Word of God. Joel chapter 2, verse 28. "This is that which was spoken of by the prophet, saying, In the last days, saith God, I'm going to pour out my spirit upon all flesh." And then he began to preach to them about Jesus Christ, how that he was a man approved of God, and that you with wicked hands have crucified, and God's raised him from the grave, and through him we now have what you see and hear, and he is now made both Lord and Christ. And when those devout Deuteronomy 6 and 4 Jews heard that the one they had crucified is now recognized as Lord Jehovah God and Christ, Messiah anointed, the Bible said they were stabbed, they were pricked in their heart, they felt the conviction of God, and they cried out. Now, men, notice, these were devout men. The Bible says in verse 5, they were devout men, Jews, out of all the nations. And said, they were pricked in their heart, and they cried out, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Now, here's the answer. If that's your question, Brother Lashley, what shall I do? You want to do right. You want to be right with God. Then here's the answer. I'm not the original giver. The Apostle Peter said, repent. Now that's just what we talked to you about a moment ago. Tell God, I have sinned. I have failed. I have come short. I have thought sinful thoughts. I have spoken sinful words. I have acted in sinful ways. I have had sinful ambitions. Hello? Confess it. And say, God, that's not the way I want to live. If you will forgive me and give me grace, I will never practice this again. I will live for you if you'll give me grace. Folks, just put God on a trial. He'll give you grace. That's what repentance is. Repentance is not just a, I'm sorry I slapped you, but I'm going to do it again. No, no. Repentance is a turning away from the sin as a practice of life and saying, God, if you'll give me grace, I'm going to walk the path of righteousness. I'm going to be right with you. That's being honest. Then he said, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission, the removal, the washing away of your sins. That is a legal action in heaven when the sins are blotted out. He said, I will blot out their sins. I can't blot out my sins. You can't blot out yours. But when you go down in the water, in the name of the Lord Jesus who died for your sins, his blood blots them out. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So here's the answer. Repent with a heart toward God. Comply with the word. Be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I have seen people come up out of the water, literally blowing bubbles before they got up. When they broke the water, they're speaking in tongues. Miracle work of God. I've seen it in numerous places. The essence of personal faith in God. I trust God. I don't care what the circumstance looks like. And overwhelming, although, well, actually, you recognize your, yeah, although all of that is bad, yet I will trust God. I will rejoice in God. I will again be praising God. Hello? You go out of here today, you got the best of intentions. Somewhere down the road, you're going to stub your toe. Oh, Brother Lashley, I am not preaching you got to sin a little bit every day. I don't believe that garbage. But I am preaching that if you stumble, you have a liberty to get up and say, God, that's not the way I want to live. That's the way I used to live. You give me grace, and I'm going to walk with you. That's the essence of personal faith in God. Now, that's part A. I'll come back with A through Z, B through Z later, okay? God bless you. Enjoy God. Enjoy one another. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.